Antiquity, Professor Isabella Baldini from the University of Bologna. I will recite very briefly some points in her bio. Isabella Baldini is a professor of Christian and Medieval Archaeology at the University of Bologna. After having completed specialization studies in archaeology at the Italian Archaeological School of Athens, she obtained her PhD from the University of Bologna. Her work mainly examines ecclesiastical and residential architecture during the early Byzantine period and late antique and Byzantine jewelry. Throughout her career, she has been awarded grants from the Accademia dei Lincei, the Dumbarton Oaks Research Library and Collection of, and the Alexander Onassis Public Benefit Foundation. Her most recent research work includes the coordination of the European project BizArt, Byzantine Art and Archaeology, in which the Open University was also a partner. With great success, this project met all its goals with great success. So her excavation work so far has focused on the Mediterranean area, particularly in Sicily and Greece. I mentioned here Gortina and Kos. Apart from being the director of the Inter-University Center for Studies on Late Antique Housing in the Mediterranean, Professor Baldini is also a member of various scientific institutions. So it's a great pleasure for us to have as a guest a very distinguished Byzantinist. Today, her talk will be about Gortina. Just to remind some of you that as Open University of Cyprus, as ELPOL, we visited in our 2018, I think, study tour, Gortin. So we have memories of that. So back to our lecture tonight. Her lecture will be titled Gortin from Paganism to Christianity in the Archaeological Record. Our session will be recorded for internal dissemination, but also it will be uploaded later on our channel at YouTube. So, Professor Baldini, the floor is yours. Welcome. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Yorgo. I'm very glad to be here. It would be nice to meet, of course, but anyway, I'm very glad for your invitation, and please feel free to interrupt me during the lecture to ask or to discuss. It's not a problem. By me, we had the pleasure to have Professor Deliniannakis in Bologna last year for a class that was really crowded, and everybody was very glad to have him in Bologna. We hope that also in the framework of the Erasmus project between our universities, the Open University of Cyprus and Bologna University, we will have occasion to be in contact more and more in the future. Anyway, now I don't know if you can see my presentation.
Now it's fine.
Can you see my presentation?
Yeah.
Okay. And yes, I'm speaking about the process of Christianization in Gortin. The survival of pagan shrines until the second half of the fourth century, and the development of Christian monumentality between the fifth and the sixth century qualifies the importance of Gortin as a test case of the transformation of late antique cities in the Mediterranean. Unlike other towns that have been abandoned in post-ancient times, its identification has never been lost. as it remained alive thanks to its imposing monumental remains. Moreover, other traces of its past arrived in association with some toponym memories. The village of Agideka, with the cult of the saints who gave name to the settlement, or, on the left, the village of Mitropolis and the river Mitropolianos, previously called Letheus, as a memory of its prestigious bishopric. The name of Gortyn is also well known in the hagiographic literature thanks to the apostolate of St. Paul, who started the evangelization of Crete and invested his disciple Titus, first leader of the Christian community between the 65 and 67. However, there is no archaeological data that can be linked to Christianity activity before the mid-5th century, and since the presence of a Christian community is witnessed in reference to Titus' successor, for a long time it could not have been other than a minority group in the framework of a pagan city. In fact, at the end of the 3rd century, Gortyn still should show a well-organized system of pagan sanctuaries. Zeus and Athena were venerated on the Acropolis, and probably a temple of Hermes was located between the Acropolis and the Agora. The sanctuary of Apollo Pythio stood at the southeast of the Acropolis. To the southwest, in the area of Mavropapa, there was another important sacred building which was dismantled in late antiquity to build a Christian church. And farther west of it, there was another sanctuary close to the river and the area later occupied by the Episcopal Basilica. It must be observed that the walls of all these three buildings, Pythion, Mavropapa and Mitropolis, included public inscriptions that attest official and political functions that were performed in this sector of the city. In the Apollo's temple in particular, these inscriptions concern decrees of local relevance and agreements with either other cities of the island or with the rest of the Greek Ecumene. In the temple of Mavropapa, probably devoted to Artemis, the defender of foreign people, decrees of proxenias were exhibited, while in the sanctuary of Mitropoli, decrees and acts of manumission have been found. For the latter, an identification with the sanctuary of Latona has been proposed, who, according to the sources, was considered a deity concerned with the protection of dweller of subordinate social condition. Until the 3rd century BC, these sanctuaries along the boundaries of the city, which remained unwalled for a long time, form a kind of enceinte sacrée, according to a model widely attested in the Greek world. A further element that contributes to show the distribution of sanctuaries in the area of the temple of the Egyptian gods, founded in the first half of the 2nd century BC, immediately north of the Pythion. Other shrines also witnessed also in other suburban and urban zones, such as that of Dimitra, in the northeast western sector of the city, of Europe and the Nymphs, probably in the Praetorium district. It is possible to locate in the Agora the sanctuaries of Zeus Agoraios, Hermes, and Asclepius. From the early Roman age, close to the same area, there was a temple for the Julius Claudian family and east of the square, other important buildings, namely a large theater, an odeon, shops and private houses with floor mosaics, whose quality seems to indicate a high level of patronage until the beginning of the 4th century AD. This area was the starting point of archaeological investigation in Gaul having attracted the attention of the first researchers and archaeologists as early as the period of the Turkish occupation in late 19th century. In fact, after the discovery of the Greek inscription, Iosifa Tsigdakis, Stefano Xandudidis, Federico Alber, and Giuseppe Gerola began a partnership that is still ongoing today, thanks to a joint agreement between the Italian Archaeological School at Athens and the Ephorate of Antiquities of Heraklion, with the collaboration of several Italian universities. In the mid-4th century AD, in addition to the aforementioned sacred edifices, other temples built in Roman times continue to perpetuate the pagan tradition. The Eastern Temple of the Praetorium, for example, erected in the 2nd century AD, was restored by a benefactor called Pactumeius, with architectural members similar to the original ones. And just behind it, an altar to the Theos Ipsistos was still venerated. Propitiatory graffiti, representative plaques, continued to be engraved on these monuments, despite the gradual transformation of the area, a phenomenon proved, for instance, by the gradual abandonment of the stadium, which progressively endured until it disappeared. At the beginning of the 4th century AD, this district is characterized by the construction of the seat of the provincial governor, the Praetorium, a large public changes the general aspect of the square in front of the Sanctuary of Apollo, an area which had previously occupied by a large bath. Praetorium is also the place for the celebration of the upper classes of the empire, as in this space they were honored through statues and inscriptions. This new imposing construction undoubtedly represent an important intervention in the urban organizational system, but probably it does not affect the use of traditional sacred areas. An interruption in the pagan frequentation seems to occur only after the devastating earthquake of 365 that hit many cities in the Eastern Mediterranean. This event is followed by widespread activity of rebuilding witnessed by archaeological and epigraphical evidence. Ecumenios Dositios Asclepiodotus, the Consularis Crete, promoted the reconstruction at the Melion of the Praetorium. 19 inscriptions, mostly honorary dedication, testify to the intense self-representation activity of the local magistrates. In this framework, the late Hellenistic temple located north of the Praetorium main hall was transformed into a secretarium, and the entire neighborhood show traces of building activity connected with the Praetorium. In the Agora, otherwise, the Odeon was still in use, and the presence of a local council is attested until the early 5th century. We can observe that this wide reconstruction does not of the pagan sanctuary. Are now abandoned or destined to other functions. Obviously, this deal of the restoration of pagan edifices is by the extent of the city. The Gortinian society would not turn back. The Sanctuary of Apollo, for example, was abandoned. At the same time, In the so-called Eastern Temple of the Praetorium, the female cult statue was discovered as an element of reuse in a wall of the 7th-8th century, but within a short distance from its base. This building was restored during the 4th century, but later in time showed increasing sign of abandonment. It seems it was already dismantled in the 5th century when it was flanked by residential and artisanal structures. Also, the above-mentioned temple north of the Praetorium became a public building after 365, losing all its religious furniture and the sculptures, the latter having been found damaged and in fragments in the nearby area. The process of abandonment of sanctuaries may have been carried out in different moments and under the action of different conditions, but it started as a precise public decision of not preserving pagan heritage after 365. Generally, this implied their closure for worship. Some break-in actions against the statues may have occurred later, and in this respect, an attitude of hostility toward the pagan component of the city is plausible beginning in the first decade of the 5th century, under the reign of Theodosius II. This is the same moment when a strong opposition between Christian and Jewish communities in the city is reported by the written sources. Socrates Scholasticus, in fact, narrates a bloody episode that took place in Crete between 431-2 and 438-9. A false messiah, pretending to be Moses, after proselyzing all over the island, would have convinced the Jews to abandon their goods and activities to follow him, assuring them to lead them to the promised land. After taking all the men with their wives and children to a promontory overlooking the sea, he would have forced them to dash into the sea. The first one to jump off would have died on the rocks, while others would have been rescued by some fishermen who had approached the shore by boat, and by some Christian traders who convinced those who were still on the cliff not to jump off. Following this dramatic event, the conversion of the huge number of people to Christianity would have been taking place. John of Nicaea in the late 7th century describes the episode in a very similar way, adding that at the time of Theodosius, many Jews of Crete became Christians due to the severe persecution that had struck them, thus attributing their conversion to a different cause. It is evident that this story re-echoes in some way Theodosius' legislative effort in weakening Jewish religion organization through the elimination of their leaders, thus provoking a decrease in the importance that Jews had in the context of late antique society. And since the case of assets and revenue of pagan temples, the state and the church tend to acquire for themselves the wealth of Jewish communities, even with the replacement of synagogues with churches. Deep transformation occurred in Crete and in other Mediterranean regions during the 5th century, and with a radicalization of the process of public affirmation of Christianity and the progressive marginalization of the other religions. It is possible that in this phase, the sculptural pagan heritage underwent the most evident robbery and dismantling. Such episodes focus especially on the chipping of the attributes and the detachment of the head of the statues, actions that don't necessarily depend, however, on a single event, and that in some cases seem to have happened even before of the definite collapse of the statues themselves. The mid-5th century in Gortyn corresponded to a turning point in the development of Christian monumentalization. Until then, the Christian community had played only a marginal role in the building activity of the city, despite the long tradition of the apostolic foundation of its episcopate under Titus and the cult of the 10 saints martyred in the age of Decius, 249-51. The participation of Martyrius, Bishop of Gortyn, in the Council of Chalcedon in 451, along with a letter from the Bishop of Crete to Emperor Leo I, clearly demonstrate the importance of the local church in fostering a new sense of a collective devotion connected to the cult of the 10 martyrs, who were declared to be protectors of the whole island. The oldest hagiographical tradition concerning them refers to a translatio of the bodies of the saints from the place of their martyrdom, located near Gortyn in a place called Alonion, to the cemetery of the city, undertaken by Bishop Paul around 328. Since then, according to the hagiographer, every year a procession would have been celebrated from the place in which the holy body had been translated to the original location of their martyrdom. We have no traces of a 4th century building in Gortyn, but the memory of the martyrdom is currently perpetuated by a basilica dedicated to the Agideca in the center of the modern village. We ignore the time of its original construction. Moreover, the church was rebuilt many times through the centuries. However, despite these difficulties in dating it is meaningful that its ubication corresponds to the center of the ancient amphitheater and the same Roman floor level. In spite of the legendary details, the translation of the 10 martyrs can be useful to reconstruct some features of the Gortynian history from two points of view. On one hand, the discovery of their holy bodies constitutes a topical motif, aiming to elevate the status of the Christian community of Gortyn that reverberates on the prestige of the episcopate and the religious history of the whole island. On the other hand, the story seems to reflect real aspects of the Christian topography of the city, with the two epicenters, one of which certainly in the present village of Agideca. Until now, it was believed that the village church marked the topographical memory of the martyrdom. Another hypothesis, however, closer to the contents of the Passio, could be to consider the building as the ending point of the translation of the holy bodies. As a matter of fact, the site of the actual church of Agideca stands over a sector of the ancient city occupied in Roman late antique times by a vast necropolis. The arena of the disused amphitheater could be offered between the 4th and the 5th century an ideal place for a sacellum dedicated to the 10 martyrs. The relocation of the relics may have caused over time the original place of their martyrdom to be forgotten. So, the present church of Agideca may not therefore coincide with the real place where the saints were martyred, which, according to the hagiographical account, should be on the hill above the city. In this respect, some similarities can be found in the martyrdom of Bishop Kyrillos of Gortyn, which took place a few years later, between 280 and 304. Condemned to be beheaded, he was led out of the city on a mountain. In this case, his body was buried in the place of death and later remembered by a chapel. The new role of the Gortynian church in the second half of the 5th century is witnessed by the construction of Christian buildings. Such phenomenon often depends on the permission by the public authority and can be observed also through the increase of non-ecclesiastical edifices at the expense of pagan properties. This is evident, for example, area of the sanctuary of Apollo Pityos, which was systematically invaded by private houses and workshops from the 5th century. The development of the Christian monumentalization corresponds in many cases to the dismantling of structures with important public functions, like in the case of the Basilica of Mavropapa and the church known as St. Titus in the Agora, built from the demolition and the reuse of public buildings. Over time, a basilica on the Temple of Athena on the Acropolis, a church in the southern sector of the city, now completely destroyed, and an edifice with three apses built on a previous residence close to the modern village of Metropolis were added to this panorama of new constructions. The first nucleus of the Episcopal Basilica may have been built in this first period of Christian monumentalization as well. Only a few structural elements of this church and some architectural members survive, as for example these capitals of Proconisial marble and with gold leaf revetment. Best known the century large basilica discovered by the University of Bologna in collaboration with the Ephorate of Antiquities. This building lasted a very long time, as its history seemed to end only with the arrival of the Arabs in 824. Today I can mention the main phases of its development in the 6th century, the period of maximum monumentalization of the basilica in conjunction with the acquisition of the archiepiscopal rank by the local church. It was 63 meters long, except the courtyard, and it was divided into five aisles by two rows of columns, some of which in green Thessaly stone. Large part of the church had a mosaic floor, and mosaic covered the upper parts of the presbyterium wall as well. A few 10 meters northwest of the baptistery stands very well preserved, a baptistery, and certainly future research can be expected to find an episcopal residence adequate to the size and high level of the buildings that have been discovered until now. In this perspective, it cannot be excluded that new discoveries may also concern the veneration for St. Titus, considering the link between the Gortinian archbishopric and the devotion to its holy founder. His acts were written in the 6th century, and the peak of the prestige of the local church and the image of the same saint is presented in the 8th century seals of Andrew of Gortin, one of the most important bishops of the city. The present-day dedication to St. Titus of the Basilica in the Agora, possibly in the origins of the church of the Theotokos mentioned in Andrew's life, might be the result of a later acquisition after the final destruction of the Episcopal Church caused by the earthquake of 795. It may therefore have been a case of transferring the episcopal function and its dedication to another church in Gortin after the primitive, large, late antique basilica had ceased to function. Coming back to it, namely the prestigious 6th century building, the presence of an original embo at the middle of the main nave can be supposed. It belongs to the same phase of the floor mosaics adorning the basilica commissioned by Bishop Theodoros, who is mentioned in a mosaic inscription at the entrance of the building and in written sources in 536, 39 and 53. Later interventions, as for example as restorations of the floor, a synthronon built in the presbytery, and some other building activities, can be ascribed to Archbishop Vetranius, who left a second inscription in the central nave of the basilica. He ruled the diocese of Gortyn in the third quarter of the 6th century, and this chronology is based on the fact that his successor John is remembered in two letters by Pope Gregory I in 597 and 99. Vetranius is also remembered in the monograms of two capitals coming from the actual Church of St. Titus and a less known basilica in Matala, harbor of Gortyn. The late 6th century ambo of this phase, the Vetranius I, had two facing staircases with an upper platform supported by eight columns. Two bases pertaining to it are still visible, bordering a large oval surface. It seems probably that this unusual typology imitates the famous ambo of Hagia Sophia, which was described in detail by Paul the Silentiary in 563, after 5 years from the collapse of the central dome of the church occurred in May 558. In Hagia Sophia, the ambo was elevated over a basement, its platform was supported by eight columns, and in the space beneath it, cantors took place. A circle of eight columns, higher than those supporting the platform, surrounded its main structure. It was called, as is known, Pyrgos Tower by Paul the Silentiary, and had the polychrome marbles and silver and gold revetments. Compared to this model, the ambo of Metropoli is, of course, a simplified imitation for dimensions and decoration. The adoption of a Constantinopolitan model during one of the most prestigious moments of the Gortynian episcopates fits well with the period in which the ties between Gortyn and Constantinople are emphasized also by the importation of architectural and liturgical artifacts in Proconnesian marble, the same material that is often reused in the later phases of the church. The existence of a new monumental religious epicenter of the 6th century does not seem to have involved a shift in the location of the structures for administrative and judicial uses, and as it's made clear by the survival of the Praetorium. The basilica, the administrative basilica, maintain its specific characteristics and layout up to the years, the early years of the 7th century, when it was affected by important changes concerning the plan, with an extension and a change in orientation towards the northern main street. This district of the city, however, became increasingly marginal in the ceremonial concerns of the urban elite, with the isolated public area progressively invaded by a dense pattern of houses and workshops, which only partially respected the street, reusing the architectural and decorative materials. In this context, the statues that adorn the classical city don't attract interest, so they are cut into pieces and used more and more as building material. Different systems thus gradually came to being. It reused the previous monuments and areas, adapting them to different functions and new forms of frequentation. At the root of this transformation was a change in the idea of the traditional city, which conditioned the urban image in a significant way in the context of phenomena which seem only partially external to the city. A decisive role was certainly played by the local church, which tended to gradually replace public authority and remain between the end of the 7th and the beginning of the 8th century, when the Archontes moved to Heraklion, the only institutional point of reference of the local community. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Isabella, for this fascinating overview. You can stop sharing your screen now. It would be easier this way. I have to say, I don't know if you had the same experience. There were some moments of bad connection. So perhaps we should switch off our cameras. Maybe it would help. I don't know. So thank you very much again. It's time for questions. The floor is open for questions. You can use this image to raise hand at the bottom center of your screen, and I can refer to you just after you raise your you use your button. So do we have any questions? Yeah, Athanasios Koutoupalis.
Sorry, can you find my face or not?
Now it's switched off. I'll do the same. Switch off
now.
Your face is off, but you still share your screen.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So perhaps I should allow our audience to be able to speak. Yeah, it's activated. So Thanasi, you can ask your question. You can use the microphone.
Good. Okay. First of all, thank you very much. It was a fantastic presentation. Just one question I have. It's only if can we assume that Gortyn played some kind of role in the expansion of Christianity in the rest of Crete, or this transition from paganism to Christianity happened simultaneously on the island?
It's a good question. We have no so many data on this problem. We have the impression is that Gortyn play a role like a model, as a model for the other cities of the island, participating in a common trend, of course, that is common also to other cities of the empire. From what we know from the sources, for example, in the occasion of the Council of 451, the impression is that the bishop of Gortyn, the role of the bishop of Gortyn, is so strong and is a kind of leader in the framework of the diocese of Crete, that yes, probably Gortyn plays a role in this process of Christianization, only because probably of the economic possibilities that can put on the desk in the economic operation of, for example, building churches, and in this way use this way to facilitate the diffusion of Christianity in the island.
Okay, thanks. Isabella, you still share your screen, so if you can you can stop sharing your screen, and we can we can come to the next question. Any other questions? use the button raise hand and then activate your microphone. So in the meantime, I will just make an observation that I can see so many similarities with the picture we get in Cyprus, in Salamis, or in Paphos, with what you showed us, the same problems, the same features, especially regarding the transition from paganism to Christianity. And if there is still no question, I will go on asking on this matter. First of all, you showed us this famous altar of Theosipsistos. So I was wondering what is more about that? What do we know more about this altar and its use in the third, fourth century, and how important remained as a cultic site?
Yes, it was made an excavation not so many years ago, so we are quite sure of the stratigraphy and of the chronology of the layers of use of the altar. And what they say is that it was in use until the 4th century. And yes, for the stratigraphical situation and for the use of the altar for an veneration, devotion, and this is the motivation of this affirmation comes from the graffiti that are left on the surface of the altar with images of agriculture tools and also of women, probably also for a kind of fertility cult and so on. After the end of the 4th century, probably it was not in use anymore, and the stratigraphy show that it was interred more and more as all the monuments of the same area and disappeared slowly. So probably in the 5th century it was abandoned. And the temple that is very close to the altar, the Eastern temple, so-called, has the same the same phases. So it was in use until the 4th century. It was repaired by this Ptolemaeus that we know only from an inscription. Then it was abandoned and became a workshop for the production of a mosaic. So it seemed to be the same situation. Use until the 4th century and then abandon it.
All right, thank you. So, other questions? Athanasios, could you pass again? Yes, Athanasios.
Now? Can you hear me? Yeah. A question that just came. You mentioned during your lecture that that the Jews were excommunicated from the city or were sent out from the city. And I would like to ask if we have any indications for tensions between pagans and Christians during the process of this transition, or it it's something that we cannot see from the records or the archaeological material or even the written sources?
We have only signs of violence in the statues. If you, we consider about 150 statues, a good number of them show signs of chipping or defacement or some kind of violence on the surface of the statues, or they were made in, they were broken. This must happen after the 5th century. So the impression is that first there is an institutional decision to close the shrines, the pagan shrines, and maybe to use them for some other function. And maybe later there are acts of violence against the sanctuaries or the statues, not before. From literary sources, we have no indication about it.
Okay, thank you. Other questions? If there is no question, I would like to ask one more. I was wondering to what extent this 365 terminus is, so to say, artificial. I mean, in other words, what do we know about the function of these temples until the 4th century? After the century, of course, yes, this is the norm, this is very common. We don't find any public cult activity across many, many provinces. But what do we know about before this 365 terminus?
For example, from the Pythios and the Temple of the Egyptian gods, we see that they were in use. They were in use in the 4th century. We don't know exactly how, but when they collapsed, everything was intact under the collapsing of the roof, for example, from the archaeological record. So probably they were in use until the beginning, the beginning of the 4th century. We don't know if in the space, in the chronological space between the end of the use, the closure of the temples and the earthquake, what happened exactly. But anyway, when they collapsed, the statues, for example, they were still inside the temples, and so they were, they could be found, they were found from by the archaeologists that made the excavations. In another case that I know better, that is the temple north to the Pythion, instead, we don't have this kind of documentation because after the earthquake of 365, they changed the use of the building that became an office, maybe a scrinion of the Praetorium. So there is nothing of the original apparatus of the temple in that case. But it seems similar all over the city.
Okay. Any indication of cultic activity, I mean, a room designated for cult in the Praetorium? Do we know anything about that?
No.
No.
Okay. No. Probably the first phase of the Praetorium, so before the famous earthquake, they could use as the north the temple as the eastern one. So they had two temples in the same area, very close one to the other, but not a single room used for l'ararium or something like this. Or a church, because we have also to consider that after the Christianization of the area, in the Praetorium area, where an official activity was still live, we don't have a church, for example, or a chapel or something like this until the 8th century.
Okay. So any other question? You can place your question in Greek. Professor Baldini speaks Greek very well.
No.
Our students, the students of the late antiquity module, to speak out. Any questions? Come across many distinguished colleagues, friends from Greece, from Italy. So I think there are no more questions. So just to thank you very much again for this
thank you.
Excellent presentation, and remind you all of our next lecture, again by an Italian colleague, Professor Ignazio Tantilo, about some pagan survivals, bizarre, puzzling pagan survivals in North Africa in the 4th century. This is right next Thursday at 7 o'clock. So thank you very much. Good night, and please
thank
join
you.
Us.
Good night.
Session.
Hope to meet you very soon.
Yeah, hopefully. Yeah. Take care.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Bye. Bye.